The views and opinions of the host and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
See Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is brought to you by Burger King, the Central Bank of the Bahamas, the Cleveland Clinic, Dunkin' Donuts, Grand Bahama News, Prince Masters, RF Bank and Trust, and Royal Star Assurance. You're not alone.
Welcome, 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 ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon, the day following the U.S. Presidential and congressional election. So glad you could join us. You can give us a call today if you want on 323-6232, that's 323-6232, or 325-4316, 325-4316 from the Family Islands. You can call us on 242-300-5720, that's 242-300-5720. You can text us on 422-4796, that's 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043, 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969, or you can catch us on BTC Flow channel 612. That's BTC Flow channel 612. Lots of conversation happening today following upon the U.S. general election. Lots of commentary about and what did not happen. By this time, you know that the projection is, and I have to say it just like that, is the projections are that Donald Trump, the former president of the United States of America, has in fact won out over Kamala Harris for the presidential election. As it now stands, it appears that he may get both the popular vote count as well as the electoral vote count. And while the election has been called for him, that's just what it is. It's been called for him. Not necessarily all the results in yet, but I think it's fairly safe to say that he is going to win the election and return to office as President of the United States of America when he is sworn in January. Certainly for me, not shocked at all. Yesterday, I expressed the view that I thought she might win, Kamala Harris, but I also indicated that I could be dead wrong, and that in fact, whichever way it went, I said that the result would be decisive, that there would not be any uncertainty about who won one way or the other. And that turns out to be quite that way, that Donald Trump's victory, if it holds, is in fact decisive, both on the electoral college count today and on the popular vote count today. Before we get into, and it seems as if the Republicans will hold on to the Senate, having picked up a couple of seats, and the results of the House remain outstanding. So whether Donald Trump will end up in the White House with a majority Republican House and a majority Republican Senate, which would give him a trifecta of power, influence, also a Supreme Court that lean conservative, that would be quite something for him to have. And if you're going to achieve anything, well, those would be the circumstances under which you could achieve anything. Before we get into discussing thoughts, which I'd love to hear from you on about what to think about the election. Let's look at some things that actually that we know arising out of the election, right? By the numbers, things that we at this point relying on information we can get, know about what happened yesterday. That okay? Because it is a commentary to be made about things without having information that isn't in dispute. And so maybe we can look at some of those things, right? There were roughly 244 million Americans who were eligible to vote. For the most part, in the various states in which they resided, the outcome of the election in terms of Democrat and Republican was not in doubt and fairly much well along those lines. Largely what was at stake were results in what they call the swing states of Georgia, Pennsylvania, Michigan, Wisconsin, Nevada, and Arizona. And even within those swing states, there were some particular counties where the results in those counties would really determine the outcome in those swing states. For instance, Wake County in North Carolina, Cobb County in Georgia, Erie County and Lackawanna County in Pennsylvania, Miami-Dade County in Florida, Tarrant County and Fort Bend County in Texas, Kent County and Wayne County in Michigan, Brown County and Waukesha County in Wisconsin, Clark County and Washoe County in Nevada, and Maricopa County in Arizona, and Douglas County in Nebraska were counties where, as you saw them go, you would get a fairly good idea what was likely to happen in the election. While there were third party candidates in the election, they did not seem to have any real effect. It is estimated that some $15.9 billion was spent, according to Open Secret, which is a nonprofit that tracks campaign finance and lobbying figures. $15.9 billion was spent on these 2024 elections. That's up from $15.1 billion in 2020. The biggest donation, given according to U.S. News and Open Secret, biggest donation given to Kamala Harris's campaign was $56,188,072, and that was given by Future Forward U.S. That gave $56,188,072 to the Harris campaign. What was the biggest amount given to the Trump campaign? The Trump campaign got $125 million from Timothy Mellon. He's an investor. He is the heir of the Mellon banking fortune. And he is estimated to be worth, by Forbes magazine, his family, $14.1 billion, right? And he gave the Donald Trump campaign about $125 million. So Elon Musk was not their biggest donor, not according to Open Secret. So in this election, there were about 2 million Yeah. No, yeah. So let me check that. So given those numbers, let's see if we could see how things eventually turn out in this election. It seems actually this election too, that the pollsters didn't quite get it wrong. Not altogether, even though I think that they didn't quite pick up some of the indications that people were going to vote for Donald Trump in instances where it seemed tighter than usual. So let me see if I can give you some additional information here. I want you to get this information before we start talking, because some of us tend to make, you know, guess statements about things. So let's look at some of the polling results from the election, because I heard quite a number of people who were commenting on what happened and what the blacks did not do, what the Puerto Ricans didn't do, etc. So let's look at some of the polling results according to So according to the exit polls, if we look at remember the gender results were supposed to be a big plus for Kamala Harris and really, you know, take her over, especially with women. Well, according to exit results, just over half of men supported Trump. Not an overwhelming number of men supported Trump, but just about half of men supported Trump, and just over half of women supported Harris. So she did not get the size number of women voters or votes as they thought she might, given the abortion issue and her gender, et cetera. And so the margin between her and Trump, in that Trump got most of the male votes and she got most of the female votes, they kind of canceled out each other, because she didn't get a significantly greater number of women votes. So that's the first thing. And that this wasn't only across the North, in Arizona, in Georgia, in Michigan, in Nevada, in Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin, these swing states. So that in point of fact, the women vote did not give her an advantage in those swing states, and might explain some of why what they thought might be the case was not in fact the case. In North Carolina, he had a slightly, Trump had a slightly greater support from men than he got from women. And that might explain how North Carolina also in favor of Donald Trump. So that's on the gender front. Let's look at race and ethnicity. Because remember now, one of the things that was said in this race was that Kamala Harris wasn't doing as well as she needed to do with black voters. She wasn't doing as well as she needed to do with black men, et cetera. Let's look at what the exit polls found. One in 10 voters were Hispanic, for example. And this was similar to what was the case in 2020 when Joe Biden won. And according to the exit polls earlier one, Harris won a slight majority of Hispanic voters nationally. But she underperformed Joe Biden's support from Hispanic voters, which Joe Biden won in 2020 by a 33-point margin. 33-point margin. So when you don't get a 33-point margin compared to the other guy, you just get a slightly greater majority than the other guy, you're losing ground. And that's what she did among Hispanic voters. The majority of them voted for her, mind you, but not to the extent as voted for Joe Biden. These voters didn't rank Puerto Rico being called a garbage island in the floating in the Atlantic Ocean. They didn't vote abortion. What was their main concern, according to exit polls, was that the economy was not so good to poor. And for that, they gave Trump more support in being able to do something about it than they gave Harris. Okay? The economy, stupid, was what it was for Hispanic voters. Across the swing state, she underperformed Joe Biden's performance in 2020 among Hispanic voters, and that could not benefit her. In Pennsylvania and Wisconsin, remember, there are lots of Puerto Ricans in Pennsylvania. About 6 in 10 Hispanic voters supported Harris, 60%. But that was a decline from what Joe Biden got in 2020, particularly in Pennsylvania. In Wisconsin, she had a better advantage than even Joe Biden, but in Wisconsin. But in Pennsylvania, no. And Pennsylvania was the big prize, and she was not able to take that. Let's look at age. So remember, young people were supposed to break for Kamala Harris significantly, and that would be a big plus for her. Well, according to the preliminary exit polling, there were about 1 in 6 voters who were between the ages of 18 and 29 years old nationally, and they supported Harris over Trump by a 10 percentage points. So she got a significant support of the young vote. But guess what? She did not get the same margin support as Joe Biden did in 2020, because he got 24 percentage point margin from them. So yes, he got young voter support, not more than Biden. And what some people did not take account of was, while Kamala Harris needed to beat Donald Trump in various categories, she needed to beat him by not just Joe Biden's numbers in many instances, but by more than Joe Biden's numbers. And she did not, has not to this point. She did perform better, though, than Joe Biden among 65 and older voters. All right? So she split their vote roughly evenly. And she won that group by 5-point margin. She split that vote, sorry, over Trump. She split it with Trump. But Trump won that group by a 5-point margin in 2020. So Trump's performance among 65-year-old and older was less last time. So she did perform well with that group, but not as well as she needed to perform with younger voters in total. Surprisingly, Trump performed especially well with young voters in North Carolina, where he split the vote with her. Remember, she needed to win the vote. But she split that vote with him in North Carolina. She got 6 in 10 of those voters under 30 in Georgia. But he lost by a similar margin among Georgia voters 65 years and older. Right? So what happened among white voters? Right? And those white voters by education and gender. What happened there? Trump won the vote of the majority of white voters across the country. Okay, according to exit polls. Not surprising, but he did. But if you look at these voters by education, then let's see how they broke. So white voters with a college degree continued to support Democratic candidates over Republican candidates, thirds of those voters, which was about the theme that happened in the 2020 election with Joe Biden. So Harris got two-thirds of their votes, the ones with college degrees. By comparison, the majority of white college graduates who make up just about a third of overall voters voted for Harris, right? So a third of them voted for Harris. In 2020, white college graduates were nearly split in their vote preferences. 51 voted for Joe Biden, while 48% voted for Donald Trump. Okay? Now, our support among white women with a college degree was better. She got 6 out of 10 of those. And she got similar shares from them in Michigan, in Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. White men with college degrees across the United States evenly split in their vote choice between Harris and Trump. So it wasn't overwhelmingly white college voters one way or the other. It was actually evenly split between her and Joe Biden. I mean, her and Donald Trump. Among white voters, however, without a college degree, both nationally and in the key swing states, the clear majority of both men and women backed Donald Trump. Clear majority. Two-thirds of white men without a college degree supported Donald Trump, as a similar share of white women did so. So Kamala Harris did not win either white women or white men without college degrees significantly enough, but she didn't perform significantly enough for them to make a difference to the outcome. Donald Trump got those votes. What about gender by race? Now, again, remember, black men were not supporting Kamala Harris. Remember? So that was a big concern. And so Barack Obama had to get step up, what a real man does this, etc. Well, let's look at what black women and black men did. Black women and men continued to support the Democratic candidate for president overwhelmingly. 9 in 10 black women backed Harris and Biden, right, in 2020. 9 in 10. What happened in 2024? 8 in 10 black men supported Harris. 8 in 10 black men, but black men wasn't going to support her. 8 in 10 black men supported Kamala Harris. In Michigan, remember, there was always that concern about what was going to happen. 9 in 10 black men in Michigan voted for Kamala Harris, according to exit polls. And the similar number of women voted for Harris. So black men and black women gave Kamala Harris their support. Big time. Big time. Despite all the concerns that had been expressed about the theme. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll continue to look at what the numbers say about what happened yesterday during the U.S. presidential election. We'll be after this break. Together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic, your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
Are you a business owner or HR professional? RF's team of pension specialists are here to empower your employees with market-leading retirement solutions and to make implementing group pensions easy and cost-effective. With RF, starting or switching your company pension plan is a breeze, and there are no setup fees. If you're looking for strong investment performance and low fees, visit rfgroup.com or your team to retire comfortably with RF Group Pensions today. That's rfgroup.com/empower.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Stand, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. So you know that you're not, you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316. Or you can text us on 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We can also be reached from the Family Islands on 242-300-5720. We're looking at the U.S. presidential election results by some numbers that we have accessed. This text says, don't forget that in those states where abortion was on the ticket, they voted for her, but still voted for it, but still voted for Trump, which also made a difference. We talked about what the women did. Period. It was inflation, but not economy. The Economist says that the U.S. economy is the envy of the world, and whoever became POTUS would be inheriting a good economy. Well, when we talk about economy, you can't separate inflation from economy, because inflation is a part of the economy, right? And people's economy is not a macro picture of what somebody says the GDP is doing, or what somebody says unemployment is. People's economy is about their personal experience of fortune, finances, or the lack thereof. And so when we talk about the economy stupid, we're talking about how people are experiencing the economy. And this is one of the lessons that political people have to learn, is not your description of an economy that matters to people. It's their experience of the economy. And while millions of people could be benefiting from an economy, millions of people may not be benefiting from that very same economy, because the economy does not affect everybody the same way. That's why we study in economics both macro and micro economy, because there is an experience of the economy at the macro level, there's an experience of the economy at the micro level, and there's an experience of the economy at a The description of the U.S. economy on a macro level is a good one, and the envy of the world, but millions and millions of Americans are not feeling that. Let me tell you what a lot of people miss. I explained it to you all before. So you're working. You've been working for a long time. But over time, you've come to enjoy a fairly good material standard of living. You've borrowed monies, you have credit card bills, so you're paying loans. But when you look at your income at the end of the day when you then pay out all your bills. Maybe you got a couple dollars left. Not a lot of room to do lots of things that you might want to do. The economy grows, expanding, but you're still working and your wages have not gone up. So that economy has not impacted how you feel about the tightness of your finances. That's millions and millions of people in the United States of America, and that's thousands and thousands of people in the Bahamas. So no matter how much bragging politicians do about what is happening in an economy, what really matters is how experiencing that economy. And here's what is true. Even when people have made decisions that have tightened their own financial circumstances, if it isn't being improved by, in quote, the people who lead us, they blame the people who lead them for their tightness. That is a big lesson in economic political results. All right. According to exit polls, roughly half of Hispanic men voted for Trump in 2024. Right? In 2020, that was about 36%. So Trump expanded his support among his Hispanic men compared to 2020, notwithstanding all the controversy around the things he says about that kind of stuff. Didn't matter. He got a vote. And that translated heavily in Texas and in Florida. Seven in 10 Cuban Americans backed Donald Trump in this general election. He did get a slim majority of Puerto Rican votes. Slim majority, but he got a majority. Boy. Let's look at religion and how religion played out in this election. According to the exit poll, Catholic voters supported Trump over Harris by double-digit margins. In 2020, Joe Biden got the majority of Catholic votes because they were voting for what would have been the second Catholic president for the United States of America, and they voted for him by a majority of 5 percentage point margin in 2020. So Donald Trump took the Catholic votes. Other religious groups, about 60% supported Trump over Harris. And they made up about 40% of the electorate. Other religious groups, not Catholics, made up 40% of the electorate and went broke 60% for Donald Trump. Just under 20% of voters who said they were non-religious voted for Harris by a margin of 3-1. But they're a smaller group. I've always felt that Republicans, like Democrats, have not learned to speak to religious people. But their talk is more consistent with non-religious people than religious people. And the truth of the matter is, when you are in the political business, you are in the business of numbers, and you cannot ignore any group. You can't ignore the non-religious, and you can't ignore the religious. You have to be able to speak to all of them because all of them have concerns. That's why I told people, stop telling people, but personality doesn't matter. Be into their policies, right? Your personality tells you, man, people should have the right to choose how they choose and do what they want to do. You bleed that into your policies of liberalism, et cetera. Yeah, well, the personality of people who says, no, there are things that I believe are right and wrong. And you shouldn't. You have to be able to speak to them too. You have to listen to them as well. And you may have to accommodate them as well. It cannot be that the perception you people have of you is that the LGBT community gets everything they want, and the religious people who have differences with that don't get anything they want. In that kind of race, you get a religious outcome like you get. The strongest religious group of voters were white, born-again Christians. who represented 20% of voters, and they voted for Donald Trump by 80%. 80%. And that was similar to what he got in 2020. White, born again Christians. A group of people that Democrats do not speak to with any degree of respect, regard, or my perception. When I see them, when I listen to them, I don't see that language, and I've often felt that way about them. Union household. The Spectre Zhivargo Harris only had 107 days to get the message across. Do you think if Biden had stepped down earlier, the results would have been any different? That's a good question, and we certainly can get to that. Good question. And I think it's an important question. Unions across the board broke for Trump. All our union talk and look, have your unions broke for Trump? Why? I don't know. Maybe they felt like Donald Trump could get it done for them better. So those are among the things we know about the election results yesterday from exit polls. As it stands, Donald Trump has 292 projected electoral college votes. He needed 270 to win, has 224 college electoral votes. It is highly unlikely that he can, that something will change to cause that opinion. And again, by the time this is done, Donald Trump will have gotten a comfortable margin of electoral college votes. How the ultimate number of popular votes will fall, we don't know yet. Okay, if you look at the electoral map of the United States of America, you will see a solidly red map in Middle America. Right, in Middle America, in southern, mid-southern America, up on the East Coast, up to North Carolina, Republicans. Michigan broke for Trump. Pennsylvania broke for Trump. Indiana broke for Trump. West Virginia broke for Trump. Kentucky broke for Trump. Tennessee broke for Trump. North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, Florida, Alabama, Mississippi, Arizona, Las Vegas, Louisiana, Montana, Iowa, Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas City, New England, South Dakota, North Dakota, Montana, Wyoming, Indiana, Utah, all broke for Trump. Nevada and Arizona remain outstanding. Everything else broke for Kamala Harris. Right? The argument that they didn't want, you know, that Democrats have to learn to do this and learn to do that and the next thing is an argument, but Barack Obama was a Democrat and so was Joe Biden. And Joe Biden is the current president. Whatever the language was, whatever the need to speak to voters was to get them to vote for you in the majority, Barack Obama had it in 2 consecutive elections, and so did and Joe Biden had it for the one election he won. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Shabazz. Break. I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
The Whopper with cheese that Burger King Nassau has never tasted so good. It's made with 100% flame-grilled beef that's juicier, topped with fresh ingredients as usual, and even fluffier buns. Get a regular Whopper with cheese combo for only $9, including VAT, and enjoy a Whopper that's bigger, better, and tastier. The only place to get your Whopper with cheese combo is at Burger King Nassau, where it's grill time anytime.
All those loans I had were so overwhelming. Fidelity's debt consolidation loan combined all my loan payments and savings plan that pays me unbeatable interest. It's time to make that move to Fidelity. Call 356-7764.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
I marched the car. The lady run into me marched the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull out the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand.
We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon, the day after the U.S. presidential elections, for which there seems to already have been a result, which is that Donald Trump defeated Kamala Harris to become the next President of the United States of America, only the second person in the history of America to win the American presidency two times non-consecutively. One of the other things that we learned from exit polls was that most people, I think up to 70% of people, felt that the U.S. economy was either poor or not performing well, or that they were not better off years later. Joe Biden and his administration were getting very poor favorability results, hanging around 41%, and that was certainly one of the lowest that American presidents tended to enjoy at this point in their presidency. So Kamala Harris was between a rock and a hard place, because notwithstanding what the macro numbers said about the economy of the United States of America, she and her team were keenly aware that lots of Americans were not feeling the benefits of that economy. So for her to stand up and brag about this great economy they had built together with Joe Biden would have been to alienate those same people and to make them feel as if she was just naive or ignorant of what they were going through. So she never really spoke to the performance of the economy under her and Joe Biden. She simply talked about the future and what she wanted to do to bring some relief to Americans who were in need of better housing conditions or in need of elderly care and entrepreneurial opportunity and these kinds of things. And so it was really a tough space for her. It is also of note that she had 109 days to campaign. There's no question about that. It's very seldom does a presidential candidate have that short a period of time to introduce themselves to people and articulate their policies and make the rounds, all the places that she needed to make her rounds too. So she had a disadvantage in that regard. She also had a disadvantage in being a vice president under a president whose administration was not so heavily factored. She also took a hit on immigration, being the person in quote called the immigration czar. She had a lot of tailwinds going against her, but mind you, in that 109 days, they did a masterful job of trying to make a case for her on raping. But things shifted for her in the last couple of weeks of the campaign. I really, number of things started to happen during that last 2 weeks that tended to cause of the enthusiasm that had been shown, demonstrated early for her, to have waned. And I think that among those things was that the campaign, according to the media excerpt that you saw on some of the ads that they played, it came about Donald Trump and his negative. And elections are about future and about change, not about the past. And while it was necessary to point out some of the foibles of a Donald Trump, you really needed a need in a campaign to connect with the felt anxieties, desires, and aspirations of the people who are going to vote for you, voting for their future. And a lot of times, most people have breadbasket issues they're trying to deal with. They care about democracy, you know. So when people think people choosing democracy over something or abortion over something, you know, people have a multitude of things on their mind. Just some things never go away as very pressing for people, and that's breadbasket issues. If you're a politician in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas and you ain't wake up yet to the reality that people's pockets are primarily how they vote, especially when prosperity does not abound, oh, Lord, you got something coming for you. People are trying to afford to pay their bills. Donald Trump connected with that as awkwardly as he did. Oh, the price of butter high. Ain't nothing high for Donald Trump. Donald Trump could afford anything in the food store, but that doesn't matter. He was demonstrating, I know the price of butter high and the price of bacon high. And you know, he was calling things with people laugh and say, oh, you know what I mean? Like a bacon and butter. Well, listen to me. We bacon butter. Donald Trump is calling them delicious things people like to eat and getting people vexed and, yeah, that's true. I can't afford them. So, you know, it's she had a tough situation to have to contend with. Let me tell you something. Yeah, don't get mad with me. Don't get mad with me. When people feel like they're in crisis, and people feel like they're in crisis, when they feel like the moment is dark and challenging, they are looking for strength. I can tell you the truth. They're looking for strength. Like, they don't mind your enthusiasm. They don't mind your jovialness. But they're looking for strength. They're looking for strength. Now, frankly, are they looking for male strength or they're looking for strength? Now, it's easy for a man to project strength. Easy. It's built in his physique. It's built in his height. It's built in his voice. It's built in his natural aggressive disposition. It's built in his cultural, historical conduct and place in the society, in most societies. That's easy. The woman coming to project and portray that strength, oh, that's a piece of work for her. For many women, Margaret Thatcher had that strength. Prime Minister of Dominica, Virginia Child. Their disposition seemed to project strength. So when you see people thinking things a little rough out there, looking for strength. And in an election, those who project that can get an edge. Kamala did not project strength. He didn't project weakness, but it wasn't strength. It was a jovial disposition. You know, it was a calm. It was a, he was a, sophisticated lady, beautiful lady, and sophisticated lady, intelligent lady, but not that. And sometimes it was nasty. That Trump was projecting, but oh my gosh. This Texas, Mr. Laing, I believe Ms. Harris was the wrong candidate. She ran in the primaries. She was VP for 4 years. She was not well liked, and she was not consistent with her views. I believe, coupled with some other things, she was the wrong candidate. Okay, well, clearly now she was the wrong candidate because she didn't win. And when you don't win, you're not the right candidate for most people. Can you explain the Electoral College? I didn't today, I did before, but when we come back, I'll happily do that for you because we are hard on the news break. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break for news. And when we come back, we'll continue talking about the results of the U.S. presidential election. We'll be back after this news break. Whatever weather, cold or warm, then you know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Jimmy Carter carried the state in 1976.
Kamala Harris has secured 109 electoral votes. So far, none of the 7 battleground states have been called. Ashley Kurzinger with the Kaiser Family Foundation on AP Votecast findings.
2/3 of Harris voters say that the future of democracy is the single most important factor in their vote, outflanking both abortion and inflation. Among Trump voters, about similar shares say immigration and inflation is their most important voting factor.
I'm Ben Thomas.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, then you know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, please feel free to call us on 323-6232 or 325-4316. You can text us, call us on the Family Islands on 242-300-5720. You can text us on 4224796, so you can WhatsApp me on 4393043. Somebody asked the Electoral College in the United States of America, in their democracy, sometime in the 1800s, it was decided as a kind of compromise among the founding fathers that they would assign a certain number of votes to winning a particular state. So in America, you don't simply win the most votes of the people who voted, and that makes you president. You have to get a certain number of votes, they call them electoral votes assigned to states. So if you win California, you get 20-something electoral votes. If you win Wisconsin, you get like 12 or 15. I'm the win. They give you the votes of that, electoral college votes of that state. There's only one state where you can split the vote, where you can get 2 out of 5, or you can get 1 out of 5, depending on how many votes you get in that state. But all the other ones, you get all the votes once you win the state. And in order to become president of the United States of America, you have to get 270 electoral college votes. So once you get that, then you're declared the winner. Now, those votes are actually cast on a particular day in the Congress. And that's where it gets certified, right? And so that's how it works. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good day, Minister. How you doing? Papa, yo.
Hey, Papa, how you doing, man?
Thank God for life as usual. This is what I was telling you about yesterday, what I was feeling, what happened in America. Like, this could feel things sometimes, but you say you wasn't feeling it, though. You didn't know which way. But I could feel like something like that was going on. So, Minister Laing, who they blaming it on now? What they saying? What the Harris team saying? Who they blame it on?
Well, I mean, they're saying a number of things.
I mean, who taking
happened,
responsibility
right?
for not? And tell me something. You agree that the polls was wrong?
No. The polls weren't altogether wrong this time around. Actually, even at the federal and state level, the polls.
I feel like it's the same thing with Hillary Clinton when they come across like they lie with the polls and it wasn't so. They say
but
it's
you don't
so
you don't
so
no
tight.
No but Papa, you don't lie with polls. You take a poll, and if your poll results are wrong, it's because you got it wrong. Maybe your methodology was wrong.
Yes.
Maybe people weren't honest. Lying says I told you something I knew not to be true.
But
that's not how polls work.
Yeah, that's a wrong word to use. But when they do and they do it, I don't know if it's a woman thing or women thing. They did it with Hillary against Donald Trump. Now they do it with this woman.
It's not just with Hillary. The polls were wrong on the Barack and on the Trump before.
Uh-huh.
They were wrong. When Trump won first, the polls were not correct.
Yeah. It wasn't. You could tell that you talk with people over there and stuff like that on the phone or people who
travel.
No, but that's different.
See, uh-huh. conversation and you feel in a way. These uh-huh. guys have to have. They have a methodology that's rooted in a certain set of scientific methods to their thing. So they sample what they call a random sample of people, uh-huh. and they get the results they get.
Yeah, the polls. I feel like the people with their feelings. Was more stronger than the polls because you could feel it. All right? I know you could hear the polls and read the polls.
Papa, with the greatest respect to you, after the fact, many of us can write anything into things we want. I am in America. I am here in America. And I have been talking to people in America, and not a single person I talked to knew what was going on. The only people who said what they thought were going on were basically people who were campaigning for one side or the other. But most people had no idea. What was going on?
So Ms. Harris based wasn't there for her, eh? Because it sounded like they're saying that they take them for granted for years. Blacks.
Yeah, but okay, so uh-huh. I don't know if you were listening to the show, right?
Uh-huh.
What is the Democrat base? Black voters is one of them. But black men and women overwhelmingly voted for her similarly to last time, uh-huh. Joe Biden.
But not enough.
So they got... Well, no. Remember now, it's not popular vote. You have to perform in those counties and what have you by numbers that you need. And it wasn't the black votes that didn't come out for her as she needed. It was the white women votes, too, that didn't come out for her like she needed. So, you know, they have to do their analysis. I'm not prepared to be blaming anything or anyone on anything because one of the things we try to do is to look for silver bullets as to why people won or lost. You're dealing with human beings, man. Human beings to wake up tomorrow and decide I want to do A. Wake up the next day and decide I want to do B. They could wake up later on in the same day and decide they want to do something. You know, none of us could predict what human beings are going to do. I like to use this example for Bible-believing people. If you're not a Bible believer, oh, yes, don't listen to me, or listen to me and just say, yeah, but that's nonsense. No problem. The people of Israel, according to the Bible, came to God. To God. And they said, God, we want a man king like every other nation. God says, no, I'm going to be your king. You don't want a man king. Because if you get a man king, he's going to do this to you. He's going to do this. The people of Israel said, no, we want a man king like every other nation. This is them talking to God now. And you know what God say? Okay. and God gave them Saul. But you still can't predict what people can do. You go there, campaign, to try to persuade people. You're persuading people. They have their own minds to make up. You can't determine an outcome. That's nonsense. You put the best effort forward you can now. Sometimes your effort might be flawed, and so you don't get the results you want because you make mistakes. But at the end of the day, you're dealing with human beings, man. I've been in a campaign. I spoke to a woman in a campaign for 2 hours. 2 hours I spoke to a woman in a campaign. Me and her had the best conversation on planet Earth, I thought. I mean, we were laughing. She was engaging. She expressed to me how impressed she was. And the woman didn't vote for me. You know the woman told me afterwards? After the election, she said, well, Zhivargo, you ain't never asked me for my vote. Alfred Sayers did. I golly wash. This is not a predictable thing, man. You go and do your best, and when you lose, get on your backside home and go live your life. Don't sit around thinking, oh my God, I did this, and people blaming me for that and the next thing. No. You're dealing with human beings, and God had difficulty and challenges with us. This says, so is it safe to say that VP can project adequate strength to convince the voters? Personally, I don't think he was introduced early enough in the race to show the strength that the people were looking for. Well, I'm saying strength might be among the things some people were looking for. And my perception was not that she was weak, but that she wouldn't have reflected that kind of strength for people who believe they are in dark times looking for a savior. That's how I read it for that group of people. Thank you, heard your explanation. That's one of the reasons why I listened to your show as a learning experience. And I'm happy you were able to get an explanation. So now, let me say something at this point. Donald Trump has won fair and square. Apparently, ain't nobody cheat. Right? Remember? They were cheating all over the place. Right. He won. Nobody cheated. Time to heal now, says Donald Trump. Bless the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for him. Time to heal. How long that last? Great words. Hope it carries forward. I'm not prepared to sanitize what Mr. Trump did and said during the election. Did and said lots of awful things. Told lots of untruthful things. It didn't matter. People who voted for him, that's democracy. So Donald Trump is the legitimately elected president of the United States of America. If I met him today, I would call him Mr. President and give him all the regard he deserves as the holder of that office when he's sworn in. But I won't sanitize. Find the person. Kind of candidate he was. In so many ways, it was awful. Also, I have not forgotten many of the things he said he's going to do. Now, am I going to say, well, because he said he was going to do these things, therefore now we could not do this and not do that? No. Because many times people say things that in the end, they end up not doing. You have to watch and observe. Bahamas has to maintain a productive, cooperative relationship with its closest geographic neighbor and ally. Bahamas has to work with Mr. Trump and his administration to work in the interest of both countries. So the Bahamian leadership, rightly, has already congratulated him and pledged to work with him. And that's as best as you can do. You can and hope for the best. Hope that his policies are good for America, prospers America, grows America, makes it strong or stronger. Anyone with their right senses would never want failure for any country, much less a country with whom they share geographic, cultural, social, economic relationships. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Minister.
Hey, what's going on?
Just now, quickly. I can come off right now.
The thing you're talking about, no with problem. Them talking about cheating, remember Donald Trump say, you got to make it too big to rig, you see? It was too big to rig. That's why he could have come out and celebrate with the people, although she didn't say she lost yet.
But Papa,
it was too big
but
to
Papa,
rig.
You,
I just wanted to
yeah, rap. But you ain't believe that, though. You ain't believe it was too big to rig, though. You
what
can't
you
believe
about?
That.
If I don't think it's possible to happen, or you don't think that's what happened last night?
No, I'm asking you. You think that's what happened? It was too big to rig?
What happened? Well, I might be too young enough to appreciate to know what happened in the past, but I'm just acknowledging that that was the biggest one. How it happened, that way the thing of bells, what they talk about, Arizona, North Carolina, Pennsylvania, all of them, Michigan, Detroit, Wisconsin, and
Wisconsin.
I think it was too big. They couldn't do nothing with that. You hear when I say, although she didn't come out and
slow down a minute. Slow down a minute now. This is Z-Live. Z-Live. And try to educate people now.
Z-Live.
Papa, do you know that no one entity runs the elections in America? Do you know that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you know various states run their own elections, right?
You say various states?
Yes, each state runs its own elections
in the
state president.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now. Also, you know that many states, are Republican-leaning election coordinators, right?
Yes, sir.
Telling me, my friend, now you're an intelligent fella. You're telling me they are going to coordinate to cause Donald Trump to lose?
Thank you for then recognizing me coming across intelligent. You, I won't be intelligent like
I
you.
I no question
me.
About that. You're a very good thinker.
To answer your
very
question, question, I'm not saying someone was plotting it. I just saying some persons was thinking, like, you got to make this so big, even if you get bad intention, Minister Laing. It's too big to rig. You feel me? You hear what I'm saying to you? I understand your question.
I understand what you are saying, Pop. But I'm just saying...
Well, maybe it was dumb to say it, and maybe it's a dumb thing. That sound better?
No. I'm just saying... I mean, come on, man.
It was big.
America,
that's the most I ever know
it
ever been, unless you know some more way it was...
But that's not true. Barack Obama won by a bigger margin than that. Ronald Reagan won by a bigger margin than that.
But they were saying it was so tight. And look at what Donald Trump going through, Barack and Reagan ain't going through. They still want to send him to jail. They almost kill him twice. My point is what I... Sorry for rushing.
Papa, now I honestly, this line of discussion, I don't want to carry on. They don't want to do that. For me, that's bringing down the level of our discussion, and I don't want to do that. I'm sorry.
Keep up the good.
Yeah, man. Thank you, bro. Appreciate it. My God. You can't even win with grace no more in the world, man. You can't win. Grace no more. You can't win. Really? I mean, what kind of planet we living in, man? All these conspiracy, doggone theories about, my God. Donald Trump won. He won in an election process. That's the theme of every election process that elected Biden, Obama, Clinton, Reagan, the Bushes, the Fords, the Carters. No, y'all, listen, man. Don't do that to me. Like, save me the time. The fact is, Mr. Laing, I think white women will always prioritize and gravitate towards supporting their fathers, husbands, and sons in pursuit of power and self-interest. What do you think? I don't know. I honestly don't know. I can't say that that is true, but I can't say that that is untrue. But I don't know. We have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Laing.
Go ahead. Yes, ma'am, I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm okay, thank you. I was listening to what Papa was saying. And
right.
I think one of when you made the comment, you know, you didn't want to take the conversation in that direction. I think we as observers of the U.S. election, we need to be careful what we allow ourselves to give in to. Because, like you mentioned earlier, we're all aware of the type of candidate Mr. Trump was, the type of candidate Mrs. Harris was. And when you take those things into account, then I can kind of understand why some people want to take the discussion in that direction, simply because of some of the untruths, awful things that were said. But we have to be careful. We need to listen to everything and put everything in context, taking into account the entire picture, because if we are holding true to the same standards yesterday as we are today, then some things are just nonsense. And we have to call it what it is.
So let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question, because here's my thought about some of that, right? Do we not have an obligation to at least have some support for the things we utter out of our mouths, rather than simply because somebody echoed it, I should say? Do you not think so? Like, if I'm going to say it was too big to rig, like, couldn't I have a basis for that?
Of course. Indeed, you should. Actually, my husband and I just had this conversation this morning with our 17-year-old, because we were, as many other people, we were watching the elections, we were watching the rallies, and our son said this morning, these are the reasons why he was supporting Mr. Trump. But then he made a statement, and I had to say to him, I said, but you don't just repeat something because someone else says it. I don't care who it is. If you don't know that to be the case, well, then you do your due diligence as best you can. And if you still can't determine, oh, yes, that is a fact, just leave it. Why tie yourself on to someone or to something that could possibly be untrue, that could possibly be unkind? You know, I think we just need to be careful and try to be thinkers as opposed to just followers. You know, because the conversation with the three of us, it evolved into local elections. The next time we have our general elections, our son will be old enough to vote. And we're trying to get him to understand that you need to be a thinker. Don't just tag on to it, even if it's a friend who said it, it doesn't matter. If you don't know it to be the case, you try to find out as best as you can. If it is, and if you still can't determine that, you leave it alone. Just leave it alone. Right. Don't repeat it. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. Lang.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your calling. Ronald Reagan won 97.58% of the electoral vote. He won 525 out of 538. He swept pretty much the electoral college. And he got 58.8% of the popular vote. Donald Trump didn't get that. Not even close. George Bush got 79.18% of the college electoral votes in 1988. And 53% of the popular vote. Donald Trump didn't get that. Bill Clinton got, in 1992, 68.8% of the college electoral vote. 317 college electoral votes. He got 43% of the popular vote. Donald Trump didn't get 68% of the electoral college votes yet. Clinton got 70% of the Electoral College votes in 1996, of the popular vote. Donald Trump didn't do that. Let's look at Obama. Obama got 67.8% of the college electoral votes. This black man, under the same electoral system. And he got 52.93% of the popular vote. Donald Trump didn't get that. And nobody said he cheated either. John McCain didn't say he cheated. Mitt Romney didn't say he cheated. Donald Trump, when he won in 2016, he got 304 electoral votes, 56.5%. That's not one of the highest. And 46% of popular votes. Joe Biden got 306 of the electoral college votes and 56.9% of the popular vote. Similar to what Donald Trump got in 2016. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Oh, hi, Mr. Laing. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing okay. And yourself?
I'm good, thank you. Yes, you good. Know, and that's the previous caller, she was so right. She was so on point. Our messaging would be speaking, would be saving, to be so careful, would be put out there on repeating certain things that you're not too, you know, quite sure about. I make that mistake a lot of times as well. But in reference to the elections, I heard a lady, an American lady, speak about her 12-year-old son came to her highly upset last night, saying that, Mommy, am I going to have to pick court now? You understand the psyche with the child to be thinking like that now that this president has, you know, Mr. Trump has won the election. But I put it in context to, I remember my granddaughter, it was, I forgot the year when the government, you know, was after the election year. And that morning, Mr. Laing, she came in our bedroom, washed over in tears. She was she was only about 9-10 years old. She was terrified. She was petrified to go to school or to go outside because she felt as if the boogeyman or boogeyman and women were going to come and get her because, you know, we didn't support the party, right? So what happens is as done in America, I'm guilty, we're guilty, my husband and I are guilty, you know, for this, because we discussed certain things. It was only in jest, saying that if he wins, we're going to go back to, you know, picking cotton and, you know, back in those days, right? And certain things, I guess, we said, and the hype, and sometimes, you know, the vitriol with campaigns and whatever, the children are listening and they're watching, and they take it seriously, so we have to be careful how we'll be saying, we'll be, you know, as far as adults in reference to elections, because it could get intense at times.
Yeah.
That's all I really want.
And we just be a little more graphic, because, you know, we use that expression, you can stone start picking peas out of.
Exactly. And, you know, you get, because you, trust me, you know, you get caught up in that hype and that, you know, feel and whatever. And one last thing. With the crowd sizes and whatever have you, and the young people, like with Kamala Harris, with the crowd, and Trump, they are the big crowds too. You can't trust those crowds, because they hype you up, but when it's time to show up at the polls, a lot of them don't turn up for you. So that's another thing too, probably that they might have gotten a little excited about, but ended up being disappointed. But you take care.
Or, you too, thank you very much for calling. Or, people could do one thing, but for whatever set of reasons, whether it's historic or cultural or familial or whatever, they do another thing. I have a friend of mine, dear friend of mine, who said to me that he went to the polls in 1992 to vote FNM, because he was like, most young people were thinking change, but he comes from a strong PLP background. He said, and he went to the polls to vote FNM. He said, but when he got in that booth, he said to himself, nah, I gotta do this one for Finland. And he voted for PLP. So you might have your mind to do one thing, but as you go there and start thinking seriously and have to buck against all that momentum in your heart and the culture in your family and all the history, you sometimes you just do something different. And that's how it goes. Listen, man, I tell people, if you are a candidate in a political process, if you are foolish enough to think exactly, and these people have to vote for me, then if you lose and you take it to heart, you get what you deserve. You should always election as a candidate knowing this vote belongs to them people. If they give it to me, it is because that's what they want to do. If they don't give it to me, that's because they have the choice to do it. And at the end of the day, Zhivargo Laing, going home and saying, thank you very much for the opportunity. That's that. I move on. I'll never forget, well, a couple of weeks after we lost the election I last lost, I was out there doing a seminar and what have you. And my friend said to me, he said, Zhivargo, one thing with you, but you don't hang up at all. I mean, you just move right on. I went, well, what else was I supposed to do? Go down and cry because people decided how they wanted to vote. Take it personal. People decided how they wanted to vote. They don't want to give it to Zhivargo. That ain't personal. And even if you give it personally, there's no right. I don't own nothing. I don't own you. I don't own this country. Nobody has no obligation to vote for me. Not at all. FNM, PLP, otherwise. And so I never go to the polls, taking anything personally. Even when people walk up to me and tell me, Mr. Laing, I couldn't support you. I support you. I don't like it. But hey, what I could do. And I feel bad about it. I could do. That's your vote. Belong to you. And I have no control over it. None whatsoever, other than to try to make my case, be as persuasive as I can. And if that isn't enough, then God bless you, man. This text says, good afternoon, Z. Trump has proven resoundingly that he is a genius and a master strategist, and that Kamala was out of her depth and weight class. It is evident that Trump is light years ahead of his opponents in strategy and thinking. Kamala had performance, but only one cogent policy, and she stole that one policy from Trump. No tax on tips, landslide, and sweep, only God. First of all, my friend, this is what you do when you get caught up in your own exuberance, right? You're using all these exaggerated words about Donald Trump. Did you listen to Donald Trump's speech after the election? He started talking, he said, wow, look at, he was surprised himself. So stop talking nonsense. Donald Trump was surprised at the outcome. He did not expect that. Don't give me nothing about strategy. Now, I would tell you, my mind, Donald Trump does have his hand on the pulse of a group of Americans that the Democrats seem not to be connected to. That's a fact. Donald Trump also is masterful at marketing and manipulation. Masterful at it. It's been his life. No question about that. And if that helped him to win, then you're trying to win. But don't give me this nonsense talk about Kamala taking policy from Trump. That's as ignorant a statement as I heard in this election. Ignorant. That's nonsense. Stolen what? Really? Do you know Kamala's policies? Do you know Donald Trump's policy? Come on, man. Seriously? And landslide what? It was only God? God did this? Did he tell you that? God told you, I did this for Donald Trump? That's what God told you. And if Donald Trump was such a master, how come Biden beat him? Biden beat him. What happened to the master then? What happened to God then? He was running for re-election. Was he not God's man the first time he won? He wasn't God's man the second time he won? Oh, come on, man. Think and be intelligent when you talk. And when you call this show, please. Think, man. So that there, that sounds like ridiculous to me. The Trump currently has 51% of the electoral vote and currently leads Harris by 5 million in the popular vote. Okay. Great. We're going to take a break, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Are you looking to save for a big purchase or occasion? Do you want your money to start making money for you? Well, let me introduce myself. My name is Bond, the Bahamas Government Savings Bond. I am guaranteed to earn interest on your money with terms ranging from 1 to 6 years. Government Savings Bonds are available to all Bahamians, and for as little as $100, you can start to save for your future. The Bahamas Government Savings Bond, a safe investment guaranteed. Check out the Central Bank of the Bahamas website for details.
This October, Dunkin' Donuts is brewing more than just coffee. We're brewing strength because we're stronger together. Donate at any Dunkin' location to support breast cancer awareness. Together, we're making a real difference for the Sister Breast Cancer Support Group. Sip, smile, support. When we stand together, we're stronger together because the Bahamas runs on Dunkin'.
The Grand Bahama News is available every Tuesday in the Nassau Guardian. You can buy your local paper at Freeport Convenience Stores, Western Bakery, DeGregory's Fine Foods, and Bellevue Gifts. Now is the time to reach your Grand Bahama market with affordable packages, including print and digital. Call GB News Sales Representative Kavandre at 822-6717 or message him on WhatsApp for ad rates every Tuesday as well. Keep up with everything Grand Bahamian every Tuesday in the Nassau Guardian.
Are you a business owner or HR professional? RF's team of pension specialists are here to empower your employees with market-leading retirement solutions and to make implementing group pensions easy and cost-effective. With RF, starting or switching your company pension plan is a breeze, and there are no setup fees. If you're looking for strong investment performance and low fees, visit rfgroup.com/empower and empower your team to retire comfortably with RF Group Pensions today. That's rfgroup.com/empower.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back to Z Live, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're so glad that you could join us here at 0.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316. From the Family Islands, 242-300-5720. You can text us on 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. Talking about the outcome of the U.S. presidential elections, as far as we know them to be today, Donald Trump seems to have won the election, having defeated Vice President Kamala Harris. I know she feels badly today. And not just disappointed today, no doubt. Donald Trump is elated, and his supporters are elated. Some of them are gloating. They understand that. Do that, you win, you gloat. And that's okay, right? When you lose, you're sad. When you win, you're happy, and you gloat. Some people gloat. I want to mention a couple of things here. One of which is the Harris campaign has to ask itself some questions so that the Democrats can benefit from it, because this is going to work. For instance, in many rural Democratic districts, Joe Biden performed better than Kamala Harris. The question is, was that Kamala, the person? Was that her gender? Was that her race? Was that her message? Whatever they think it was. In those rural districts, see, Donald Trump, those, I don't know if this was their strategy, but it appears to have been their strategy. Donald Trump, though, said, listen, I'm not going to win these Democratic counties and districts, but if I could reduce their victory margin and make up the margins in the ones that we win, we can get it. And that seemed to have worked. So the Democrats have to look at that. Secondly, I am not prepared to say America is going to fall apart under Donald Trump. I am prepared to look and see what happens, right? I ain't got to say a word about this going to happen or Donald Trump be terrible for America. I'm not in that business. I'm going to watch and see, hope for the best, pray for better, right? We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Yes, good afternoon, Mr. Laing.
Yes, sir, how are you?
Yeah, you did a splendid job in the first hour. I like the way you break down with respect to the U.S. presidential election last. I stayed up until 2 o'clock and watched the entire thing before I actually went to bed.
Okay.
And I know they haven't done their post-mortem yet, but you did. I like what you say. But I think, I will say this in my opinion, I think Ms. Harris ran a good campaign. I think she was very, very, a campaign was well organized. And I think they did a splendid job. But I think that she lost on a lot of issues that when she was asked by the press, how would her administration be different from Joe Biden, she stumbled. In fact, she never answered that. And there were one or two other questions that she was asked by the press that she didn't have an answer for, immigration, etc. And that was a critical aspect of her downfall, not being able to secure the Latino vote and not being able to secure the black vote, especially the men.
No, she did very well among men. Very well. I don't know if you heard us, but the exit poll, she did very well among black men.
Yeah, I mean percentage-wise, I mean, to compare with what Biden and Obama and them got from that sector.
She did compare. She got, especially in some of the swing states, she got like 80.
Yeah, but the Latino, what? I didn't know they was going out much for Trump, but They really went hard for Trump. And of course, the white educated Americans, college, etc. Yeah. When I saw those states like Pennsylvania and all of them, those which was basically blue for the most part, and I saw all of them fall, I said, that's it. I didn't see a pathway to her becoming winning the vote that she needed. And so I said, one of the coordinators of the campaign came and gave a brief statement, and they turned all the music off. They turned off they were watching, and they actually turned off the television, so that tell you what time it was, and they decided to play music. So that was it. But overall, I think she did a good job for the short time that she got in.
Mm-hmm. You know, it was a telltale sign for me that, things wasn't when they asked some of the people who were supporting her, what they were hearing from the insiders in the campaign, they were saying that they are encouraged. Let me tell you something. When you hear people in political campaigns say they're encouraged.
Not that they're feeling good. Were saying 49-49, so I say this is really tight.
Yeah. Thank you for calling, my friend. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
Producer, do we need to take our final break, or we took that already? Because I've lost my way. Are we taking our final break, or do we need? Just want to make sure. Okay, let's take our final break, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be back and finish up after this break. You're listening to Z-Live on the Bob Delaney Show.
Everybody, everybody. come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm or the war. Let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
You try to rest, but roll with the best. For all your printing needs, there ain't no one better, no. For posters and banners, magazines and flyers, for window decals, greeting cards and newsletters. No job too big and there's no job too small. You name it, we can print it, just give us a call. Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located at the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 302-2361.
Do you have uncontrollable debt? Are you ready to make that move to Fidelity for a stress-free future? These loans have a built-in savings plan that pays you unbeatable interest. Ask about our debt consolidation loans today. Call 356-7764.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
Hey, Master God, the lady run into me, Master God.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hi. Good afternoon, Mr. Laing. How are you? Hello.
I'm good. How are you?
I'm yes.
Yes. I'm listening.
I
you
truly
are you?
Benefited from listening to your overview of the elections today, and I don't usually get involved in political, elections and the rest of it, but I want mm-hmm. to congratulate Miss Kamala Harris. I thought she did a very good job. She put up a very good fight. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm looking at mm-hmm. it from the viewpoint that we knew that President Trump was going to be running some 3+ years ago, whereas Miss Harris mm-hmm. entered the race kind of a late. I would say maybe 4 or 5 mm-hmm. months. I thought she made a very good showing, and congratulations mm-hmm. to her. I would just like mm-hmm. to quickly share something with you when you talk about sure. you don't know exactly who you're going to be voting for. I recall a few mm-hmm. years ago in the constituency where I lived, mm-hmm. the two persons running for the parties, I knew them very mm-hmm. well. I was very friendly with them, and as I mm-hmm. entered that gate to go to vote, mm-hmm. I ran into both of them. I greeted both of them, and I, right away, I said, when I got in the booth, mm-hmm. I didn't vote for any of them. I voted for somebody who was running as an independent, and he got 3 votes. One of those votes mm-hmm. was mine. But, you know, in this election, it takes nerve. It takes courage. So I want to congratulate Ms. Harris. She did a good job. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for sharing that story, too. This text says, good day, Mr. Laing. I'm so glad that Mr. Trump won the election for many reasons. They could not cheat this time. Well, see, how do you know they cheated last time? Tell me that. Yeah, that you're making that point that they cheated? So only when he wins, they don't cheat. And he loses, they cheated. Really? So the U.S. needs a no-nonsense man like Trump to make the U.S. heal and make the U.S. great again. Okay? I strongly believe that Trump will stop the war and not allow a third world war. He is going to fix and improve the borders. Okay. If Mr. Harris had won, he would have to take directives from Biden and Obama. The people did not want that. And that's the kind of credit you give that intelligent woman. You tell your belief is that that intelligent woman has to take directives from Biden and wow. That's incredible to me. And Trump should have won the last election. If he should have won the last election, he would have won the last election. That's how we go around doing it. He should have won. Wow, boy. It's amazing. But you believe what you believe. Honestly, fascinated by this string of conspiracy theory that has embraced some people. Fascinated by it. I've even read research papers that I hope would sort of inform me as to what are the characteristics of the people who tend to embrace these conspiracy theories. And I am amazed. I am amazed. I'm no longer amazed because I used to think that character mattered in elections, the character of the people running. That's not true. It matters depending on the people and circumstances. Some people would not allow a Zhivargo line to say certain things and get away with certain things without saying, I can never support it. But other people say the same thing and they say, well, I support him. He's a PLP, he's an S&M, I can support him. But that's just how it goes. If Kamala Harris and Barack Obama spoke the words that Donald Trump spoke over the period, the course of a campaign, I couldn't see it. I couldn't see them getting, I couldn't see somebody saying in to support Trump, supporting them. They think the worst of them. But apparently Donald Trump, it's a thing Teflon to his self. When it comes to things he says and does. We got a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We've got a short period of time.
Mr. Laing, how you doing, sir?
Right here, man. What's up?
Yeah, everything all right.
I have a short period of time.
Yes, I mean, but I know she's glued. I know she was glued. I mean,
okay.
She was insignificant as vice president. And the one thing she was known for the most was her laugh. You know what I mean? So, she didn't have the support of the black community that she needed, but I was surprised to hear of the Trump getting the Latino vote, according to y'all, because I thought that they would have voted against him, seeing that he was seemed to be so tough on the immigration issue. But I know she was going to get marshaled, Mr. Laing. That was no surprise. But thank you very much. You have a good day.
Yeah, you're the only person who knew. You're the only person who knew on planet Earth, and you knew that. No, you believed that. You knew nothing. You believed that. You can't know the future. None of us can. You could only believe things about the future. Absolute nonsense. And she was an insignificant vice president. That's just nonsense talk. What's ignorant talk to me? What vice president you know is significant? Name them for me. Are you Dick Cheney? Dick Cheney supported us. Matters of the election. We can wait and see what happens. I am truly disappointed. I wanted Kamala to win. She did a yeoman's job with the short time she had to campaign. I wish her all the best. I have never been confused. One day when I went to the poll to vote, I knew who I was voting for, Mr. Laing. I pray for your continued healing. God bless. Mr. Trump is not a kind human being. It's amazing why people will not vote for you. Oh, hey, people don't vote. People don't vote. Some people will now vote for me, Ingram, Edlin, Braves, just because that's it. Say, who is more significant than Joe Biden as VP? Or Don Quinn? More insignificant, than Joe Biden or VP? Or Don Quinn? Yeah, that's just nonsense. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to C.